Number 10, the eyeball man. Can anyone honestly say they aren't scared of this guy? The dude blacked out his eyeball, so he looked like a demonic Jack Skellington. More like Hack Skellington. Eyeball man's real name is Jason Barnum and is currently living out a 22-year sentence for shooting an Alaska police officer. Barnum's crime was heavily influenced by a hefty addiction to chasing the dragon. Three officers were investigating vehicle break-ins and burglaries in South Anchorage and spotted a vehicle related to the attacks in a hotel parking lot. They checked out the security footage and saw a man carrying a tote to room 209. Barnum and two others were in the room, and when officers entered the bathroom, the shootout began. Barnum was injured in the arm, but they arrested him when he got out of the hospital, and they had to deal with how terrifying he looks, even though he's behind bars. So, yeah. Number 9, Eric R. Rudolph. Resourceful and resilient, Eric R. Rudolph quickly got on America's most wanted list. Why? Well, during 1996 to 1998, Eric detonated bombs 4 times in Atlanta and Birmingham, taking the lives of 2 people and injuring thousands. A 5-year manhunt ensued. He was finally caught in May 2003 after he was found rummaging through a dumpster. Later, it was revealed how intense his survival skills were. For 5 years, Eric foraged off the lands and survived off of buried barrels of grain and soy. He learned the schedules of when produce was going to be thrown out at grocery stores and stole what he could where it wouldn't be noticed. His motivation behind the bombings was a compilation of radical anti-gay, anti-abortion, and anti-government. The list goes on. He didn't get along with other people, and when he confessed to his crimes, he showed no remorse. But when he was taken away to go to prison, authorities report that the man had tears in his eyes, knowing he was utterly defeated. What can I say, man? Your actions brought you to where you are now, so sorry about it. Sorry, not sorry. Number 8, Robert P. Hansen. The man the FBI was afraid of, and he was right under their noses. Joining them for lunch in the cafe, grabbing coffee with them, laughing at the cooler. But all the while, Robert P. Hansen was a mole. On February 18th of 2001, Robert was arrested and charged with committing espionage on behalf of intelligence services for the former Soviet Union and their successors. He was caught red-handed placing a package containing highly classified information at a park in Vienna, Virginia for his Russian handlers. When the FBI searched his apartment, it became apparent his payment was in cash and diamonds with a value of over $600,000. Hansen handed over dozens of delicate files, including FBI counterintelligence investigative techniques, sources, methods, operations. He exposed the FBI's secret investigation of Felix Bloch, a foreign service officer for espionage. He pled guilty to 15 accounts of espionage on July 6, 2001 and was sentenced to prison without the possibility of parole. He is considered the most dangerous spy in FBI history. God knows what he said. Number 7, David Carpenter. I know Lisa Rinna from Dancing with the Stars because I love a good foxtrot. Love it. But she's actually more well known for being a desperate housewife. But it turns out that her very own mother was actually David Carpenter's first victim. She knew him from work and he offered to give her a ride home, and he had kids and a wife. Soon he was on top of her, hammer and knife in hand, but thankfully a cop was nearby who suspected something was amiss, so she was saved. David was sentenced to 14 years in prison, where he was diagnosed as a sociopath with a very high IQ. He was released after only 9 years and quickly went on to commit more attacks against women. Good call on releasing him, just saying. Like, what? Ugh. I hate that. I hate that. At one time, he was even suspected of being the Zodiac Killer. Instead, he became known as the Trailside Killer, who would prey on women on hiking trails. He took the lives of 10 people, though it's probable that there were more. Just 2 survived, and officers described that he was a kind of Dr. Jekyll, Mr. Hyde kind of behavior. He was super nice, but then he had this insane, psycho, creepy, dark side as well. Number 6, Zacharias Moussaoui. The ADX prison is intended as a holding cell to teach prisoners proper conduct before they are sent to penitentiaries. However, some are so bad that they are never released for fear they might inspire new crimes if allowed to communicate to those outside the walls. Zacharias is one of them. He is currently serving out 6 life sentences for assisting the hijackers who carried out the, you guessed it, the 9/11 attacks on the World Trade Center. Moussaoui was placed on a watch list in 1999 when he started interacting with Islamist extremists. He could have prevented the attacks entirely, however, he lied to the FBI about the Al-Qaeda and their plans to attack the US. He was even supposed to pilot a plane into the White House. He was arrested in August 2001 and went on trial in 2006. Throughout the trial, he praised the Al-Qaeda and was removed for several outbursts. A very different tone to the note he wrote recently in 2020, renouncing Al-Qaeda, and appealed to younger Muslims to be wary of their deceptive ways. I really do hope he has genuinely released those ideals. However, he did do it in an attempt to relax his sentence. As recently as 2018, he was still referring to himself as a natural born terrorist, so needless to say, I don't see things relaxing anytime soon. Number 5, the marathon bomber, Jahar Tsarnaev. Speaking of the ADX prison, there is yet another permanent resident behind its walls. Jahar Tsarnaev is responsible for the 2013 Boston Marathon bombing, which took the lives of 3 people and injured 250 people in the large crowd. This event shook the world, and I remember when it happened. I remember checking my phone repeatedly in order to figure out what's happening and follow with updates, and I'm sure a lot of you do too. He and his brother Tamerlane used 2 pressure cookers packed with explosives and shrapnel. His brother was shot during a police chase while Jahar was taken into custody. He was 19 when he committed the crime and 21 when he was finally tried. The trial consisted of heartbreaking testimonies from families of the injured and the dead. The death penalty was disbanded in Boston for decades, but it was considered for this case as it was a federal case. He was instead given his life sentence to be served out in solitary confinement with no opportunities to communicate with the outside world, and that is probably how it's going to remain for the rest of his life. Wow, so young. Number 4, the Nathari killers. The Nathari crimes came to light on December 29th, 2006, after 8 skeletal remains of young bodies were found in the drain of a house in Nathari, Noida. The owner of the house and the businessman Mohinder Singh Pander and the domestic help Surinder Kohli were arrested. Soon after they were found, even more bodies turned up. The village had been making noise about the disappearances for a while before anything was done, but now the Nathari killers remain some of the most horrific people behind bars. Over 16 young people fell victim to kidnapping, vicious bodily violations, and death, which believed to have occurred between 2005 to 2006. Both men have been found guilty and the death penalty is in discussion, though has been delayed. Some believe that there is money involved in the case that may result in an unfair result, but considering the severity of the case, release is not really on the table. I'm not gonna lie, it was hard to get a straight story on this. There is a lot of convoluted details across the articles I could find, so if you have more info you want to share, drop it down below. Number 3, Larry Hoover. This dude is so powerful that he was continuing to run his operation while serving out a 200-year sentence for murder. Larry Hoover was, slash is, I suppose, the chairman of the notorious Gangster Disciples gang. He was convicted 2 decades ago of continuing to run his empire behind bars. Hoover, now 70, is serving out 6 life sentences at the Supermax Federal Prison in Florence, Colorado, a facility that holds the worst of the worst. Terrorists, mobsters, anyone who'd be a danger to anyone from the outside. It is said to be the most secure in the country. He established the gang in Chicago in the 1960s and has recently decided to try and take some of them down. The indictment accused 7 state and national leaders of the Gangster Disciples of racketeering conspiracy, drug trafficking, witness intimidation, and multiple murders, including the 2018 death of a 65-year-old ranking member of the gang on Chicago's South Side. Beware if you've ever crossed Larry Hoover, because even behind bars, you can't stop him. Number 2, James Marcello. I honestly sound like I'm in a 1940s film noir when I was researching this. You'll see why in a second. He is the highest ranking Chicago mob boss in prison, also known as Jimmy the Man Marcello. Now at the age of 76, he filed a petition in June 2020 to have his sentence tossed out. Jimmy was one of 5 top criminals who were convicted of the 2007 Family Secrets racketeering case. He was convicted of taking the lives of Tony the Ant's Belotro and his brother Michael. They were found in a cornfield in June 1986 after being beaten and strangled to death in Jimmy's basement. He was sentenced to life in prison in 2009 and currently resides at the Supermax facility in Colorado, just like Mr. Hoover. Marcello's father was also in the biz, and so was his big brother, Big Miggy. The family had influence. There were crimes that hit the news and crimes no one knows about. Either way, now Jimmy wants out. He's like, ah, come on, give an old guy a break. Not for you, Jimmy. Not for you. And last but not least, Monstrous Maudsley. Ooh, when I started reading about this guy, I literally had to step away from my desk. There were some images I just didn't want to read, but here we are. Meet the man, so dangerous that he is now kept in a below-ground glass box in complete isolation. Not only did he take lives outside of prison, but inside of it, he was the man everyone feared. The point that made me turn away was what he did with a spoon, which dubbed him the nickname of Hannibal the Cannibal. Robert Maudsley has been locked away in a glass box just like the infamous villain, for over 40 years. He was sentenced to life in prison after taking the lives of 4 people. His crimes were so violent, the cops nicknamed him Blue because that was the color of the first victim. But his crimes did not end behind bars. He brutalized and took the lives of abusers of young victims behind bars in vicious and terrifying ways, just like you would predict people would do in prison. He was so volatile and like laissez-faire about it that the only thing the prison thought to do about it was build him his own cage. He is allowed 1 hour of exercise a day. His childhood was riddled with abuse, and he would often take most of it to protect his siblings. This violent childhood, along with his extreme intelligence, resulted in a violent appetite. However, after 40 years of psychiatry, appeals are being made to improve his well-being. Honestly, he did some awful stuff. If there is even a way out of the dark for even the worst and the worst of us, then it should be at least attempted. That's my mentality of it, but man, oof, creepy. Starting off this countdown, we have Richard Matt. Matt's career as a criminal started off when he was young. He was involved in robberies, kidnappings, and then eventually murder. The first murder he committed was of his former boss. He then fled to Mexico to avoid being caught. While there, he murdered a second man while attempting to rob him. In 2007, he was convicted for the murders and began serving a 25-year-to-life sentence. But guess what? 2015, he actually escaped the facility with a fellow inmate, and they spent 20 days on the run before getting re-caught. And apparently he has a history of jailbreaks, so I don't know why they just didn't pay closer attention to him. In the end, this was his final escape, since he was caught and killed by Border Patrol while trying to flee to Canada. In our 9th spot, we have the dating game killer. This dude gets his name because while police were looking for him, he appeared on TV for an episode of the dating game in 1978. He did this in the midst of his murder spree. In fact, the dater on the show actually chose him, but when they met afterwards, she said that she got a bad feeling around him and they never actually went on a date, which that was a close call for her, because during his appearance on the show, he had already murdered at least 5 women. His date would have probably been his next victim. This killer would often toy with his victims. He would strangle them until they lost consciousness, then he would revive them, and then repeat this process several times before taking their lives. In the end, he was convicted of murdering 5 women, but police think that his kill count is much, much higher. In our 8th spot, we have the razor blade. This story comes from a prisoner who was locked away in a Texas prison. The prisoner told the story of a fellow inmate who everyone feared. It was this woman who would violently lash out on her fellow inmates. One time, she even put a razor blade in a bar of soap and would use it to cut up other prisoners. When the guards found them, there was blood everywhere. So yeah, I can see why people fear her. I wouldn't want to get on her bad side, let alone even look at her. Moving on to number 7, we have Ronnie McPeters. One of the scariest inmates in the world is said to be Ronnie McPeters. Ronnie was sent to jail for the murder of a 27-year-old woman in 1984. The woman, Linda Marie Baltazar, was running errands when Ronnie came up to her window panhandling. She shooed him away and he left, but then he ended up coming back, this time armed. He then shot her 5 times. As a result, he was arrested and sent to Fresno jail. But his bad behavior never stopped. While in jail, he would set fires, attack other prisoners, and even sometimes would, you know, smear his feces on the walls and floors and sometimes all over his body. Now, he was actually put on death row for his crimes, but he was deemed, and I quote, too insane to be executed. In our 6th spot, we have Joanna Danahy. Joanna is a serial killer who, in March of 2013, went on a 10-day killing spree. She murdered 3 men, but her goal was to murder 9. She said she wanted to be like the killers Bonnie and Clyde. After killing the men, she would throw their bodies in ditches. In fact, she has the title of one of Britain's most notorious female murderers. While in prison, Joanna has made it a point to prove to other serial killers that she is the best killer among them. We are now at our 5th and halfway mark with the inmate from hell. So this story comes from a nurse who worked at a prison. She shared the story of the scariest inmate that she has ever encountered. This inmate would go around biting officers in their arms and shoulders. He would headbutt them as well as even punch them directly in the face. He has broken people's bones and even ripped out chunks of flesh off of them with his teeth. Yeah, that must have been terrifying to see. Like, what the heck? Moving on to number four, we have Pascal Payet. Pascal Payet is a French criminal who was sent to jail for committing a murder during a robbery in 1997. But he is famous for his daring prison escapes. In 2001, this dude managed to escape prison using a hijacked helicopter. But he didn't perform the stunt just once. No, no, he escaped twice. So obviously, he was caught and then sent back to jail. Then in 2007, he did it again. It only took him 5 minutes. Within that time frame, four masked men hijacked a helicopter and took the pilot hostage. They then landed on the roof of the prison and used some device to open the doors and get Pascal out of his cell. Like I said, they were in and out within 5 minutes. 2 days after this escape, an arrest warrant was issued against him. Nowadays, he is never kept at the same prison for more than 6 months, and he is placed in solitary confinement where he is under high surveillance. They don't want him escaping for a third time. In our third spot, we have Damien Foulkes. Alright folks, let's talk about Damien Foulkes. See what I did there? Anyways, this guy, don't get me started. So this guy was serving a life term in jail for armed robbery. While in jail, he attacked a number of prisoners. He strangled killer Colin Hatch with strips of bedding and also slashed the throat of Soham murderer Ian Huntley. And this is what he had to say to that. He said, "I hope I killed him. I've been planning it for weeks." Now, Ian Huntley did survive, but he had a 7-inch wound that just missed his jugular vein. But that's why Damien is considered incredibly dangerous. In our second spot, we have Mark Hobson. Mark Hobson went on a killing spree in North Yorkshire, England in 2004. As a result, he took the lives of 4 people. But he was also involved in a nationwide manhunt, which involved more than 500 police officers and 12 police forces all looking for him. During that time, he was considered Britain's most wanted man. And this is another dude that is not afraid to get violent with others. In September of 2005, he poured a bucket of boiling water over a fellow killer. And on a number of other occasions, he has attacked other prisoners. As a result, he is another prisoner who is kept under close surveillance at all times. And in our number one spot today, we have Robert Maudsley. Robert Maudsley has actually been named Britain's most dangerous prisoner. Now you might be wondering, Lindsay, why is that? Well, oh boy, let me tell you. In 1977, Maudsley and his fellow inmates held another prisoner hostage. They tortured him for 9 hours before cracking his head open and killing him. And rumor has it that he even ate some of the prisoner's brain. As a result, he was deemed the real-life Hannibal Lecter. A couple months later, he murdered 2 other inmates, then casually told the prison officer that during the next roll call, he would be too short. As a result, he's actually kept in an isolated glass cell so guards can see what he's up to at all times. They don't want another hostage situation to occur ever again. Starting off this countdown, we have the Man in the Iron Mask. The Man in the Iron Mask is the name given to an unidentified prisoner arrested in 1669 or 1670. He was imprisoned during the reign of King Louis XIV of France. Now, what's so scary about this prisoner is how his identity was always kept unknown. He was forced to wear a mask that blocked off his face. Some say he wore a black velvet mask, while others reported that it was a full-on iron mask. Apparently, the guards were ordered to shoot this man if he ever removed the mask. On top of that, he was kept in solitary confinement with double doors. He spent the rest of his life there until he died on November 19th, 1703. Moving on to number 9, we have Jesse Pomeroy. Jesse Pomeroy, otherwise known as the Boston Boy Fiend or the Boy Torturer, was convicted of countless murders at the age of 14 in 1875. He would abuse, torture, and then kill his victims. In fact, he was the youngest person in the history of Massachusetts to be convicted of first-degree murder. When Jesse was caught, he admitted to the murders and was sentenced to live in the Westboro Boys Reform School until he was 18. However, while at the school, he went on to commit other murders. That's when he was sentenced to prison and was placed in solitary confinement. His only interactions were with his guard and his mom, who would visit him once a month.
In our 8th spot, we have Ian Manuel. In 1990, when Ian Manuel was only 13 years old, he shot a woman in the face, blowing out part of her jaw during a robbery. Thankfully, she survived, but as a result of his crime, he was tried and convicted as an adult. As a result, he was sentenced to 65 years in prison. He was one of the youngest inmates in the Tampa State Penitentiary. Manuel spent 15 plus years in isolation, making him the longest serving inmate in solitary confinement in Florida. Eventually, he was released after the woman he shot actually fought for his freedom, claiming everyone does dumb things when they're young, and she didn't want him to waste his life in jail. In our 7th spot, we have Ian Brady. Between 1963 and 1965, Ian Brady and his accomplice tortured, abused, and killed 5 individuals. They would bury their bodies on the moors outside of Manchester, which gave them the name the Moors Murderers. The crimes they committed were horrific, and Brady expressed no remorse. As a result, he was held in solitary confinement. His only contact with the outside world was through letters. It's said that on his free time, he would memorize whole pages of Shakespeare and Plato and then recite them to himself. He would also often interact with television programs. Brady died in prison on May 15th, 2017 at the age of 79. Making our way down the list, number 6, we have Dennis Rader. Between the years of 1974 to 1991, American serial killer Dennis Rader took the lives of 10 individuals. In 2005, he was convicted for his crimes, and now he's facing 175 years in solitary confinement without the possibility of parole. Now, Dennis likes to go by the name BTK, or the BTK Strangler, which stands for bind 'em, torture 'em, and kill 'em. So that says a lot about who this guy is. But thankfully, he is locked away and has no chance of escaping. To this day, Dennis is considered one of the most diabolical serial killers in American history. We are now at our 5th and halfway mark with John Massey. In 1975, John Massey got into a fight with a pub's bouncer and he shot him in the chest. At the age of 26, he was sentenced to life for murder. But while in prison, Massey managed to successfully escape 3 times. His most notorious escape was when he made a makeshift rope out of sheets and a pair of heavy-duty gloves to climb over the prison wall. As a result of his escapes, he was placed in solitary confinement. He was allowed 15 minutes outside of his cell each day and had only 8 minutes for a phone call. Other than that, he was kept locked away. He is considered one of Britain's longest serving prisoners. He was eventually released after spending nearly 43 years behind bars. In our 4th spot, we have Thomas Silverstein. Thomas Edward Silverstein was an American criminal jailed for armed robbery in 1978. But while in prison, he committed numerous other crimes. In 1983, he killed a prison officer who he stabbed multiple times. Then he murdered 2 inmates. As a result, he had to be detained in a specially designed cell at the ADX Florence Federal Penitentiary in Colorado. Due to the crimes he committed while in jail, he is considered the most violent prisoner in America. He is also referred to as America's most isolated man. Now, Silverstein was considered so dangerous that he got transferred to a federal prison in Atlanta. There, he was confined in a 6x7-foot cell. He was constantly under surveillance. In fact, the lights in his cell were never turned off so that they could always keep an eye on him. Silverstein eventually died in prison at the age of 67. He is said to have served the longest term in solitary confinement in the federal penitentiary system. Coming in at number 3, we have Eileen Wuornos. Eileen Wuornos, often referred to as the damsel of death, was found guilty of killing 7 men. She claimed it was self-defense, but then later pleaded guilty to the murders. She would murder them, rob them, and then drive home in their cars. Due to this, she was named America's first female serial killer. Now, Eileen was placed in solitary confinement for quite some time, but then she started to grow paranoid. She thought that the people making her food were spitting in it. And then she also claimed that she was being attacked by a sonic weapon. As a result, she wanted the court to hurry up with her death sentence. On October 9th, 2002, Eileen died by lethal injection. Moving on to number 2, we have Elizabeth Bathory. Elizabeth Bathory, otherwise known as the Countess Who Bathed in Blood, was a serial killer in Hungary back in the 16th century. It's believed that she had killed around 650 girls. She's also considered the most vicious female serial killer in all recorded history. It's believed that her husband was a big influence in her killings. Apparently, he told her to torture her servants. He said for her to pour honey all over them and then let the bugs eat them. But her killings didn't truly start until she met a witch named Anna Darvula. This witch told Elizabeth that bathing in the blood of the young would help her maintain her youth. And that's exactly what she would do. Eventually, Elizabeth was sentenced to life in solitary confinement. She was locked up in her castle's torture chamber. The windows and doors were boarded up with her inside. There was only a small hole in which food was passed in through. On August 21st, 1611, she passed away. And in our number one spot, we have Robert Maudsley. Now, I've talked about Robert in my other video on dangerous criminals, and there's no way that I couldn't include him on this list. Robert Maudsley is considered Britain's most dangerous prisoner. Maudsley was originally convicted for one murder, however, killed three more individuals in prison, which got him placed in solitary confinement. In 1977, Maudsley and his fellow inmate held another prisoner hostage. They ended up torturing him for 9 hours before cracking his head open and killing him. Now, it's rumored that he may have ate some of that prisoner's brain. As a result, he was deemed the real-life Hannibal Lecter. After that, he murdered two more inmates, which got him placed in solitary confinement. In fact, he is locked up in a glass cell underneath Wakefield Jail. He spends 23 hours of his day there.
Starting us off with number 10 are Catherine and Curtis Fairchild Jones. In Melbourne, 1999, at 13 and 12 years old, Catherine and Curtis became the youngest people ever charged as adults for first-degree murder. The two shot their father's girlfriend, Sonia, and had plans to murder their father as well and another male relative for sexually molesting them. As soon as they had shot her, they realized what a huge mistake they'd made, and they ran to their neighbor's house and said it was an accident. Even after evidence of abuse was found, no one did anything. No one believed the two were being abused, and they were sent to jail. During their trial, they never brought up the abuse. Nothing about what they had endured was even mentioned. I mean, the man who was abusing them was convicted of sexually assaulting his girlfriend's daughter years prior. Why was this not brought up by their defense during their trial? I have no idea. Then the justice system failed them, and they pleaded guilty to second-degree murder and were sentenced to 18 years and probation for life. They were both released in 2015 at 29 and 30 years old. That's basically your whole prime part of life, all spent in jail. Coming in at number 9 is Artif Rafe and Sebastian Burns. Funnily enough, I knew about this case beforehand because it's a very good Netflix docuseries about different crimes, and it's called The Confession Tapes, and this was their first case that I actually explored. Highly recommend, but anyway, in Bellevue back in 1994, Artif and his best friend Sebastian came back to Artif's family's house for the holidays. All was well until the boys came back from a long night out to discover Artif's parents and sister brutally murdered and his house a complete mess. After their murder, Artif inherited basically everything his parents had, buying a new car, living a new lifestyle, and seemingly not mourning the loss of his family at all. Police in both the US and Canada suspected the two boys of killing his family in order to get their money. They slandered them in the news like there was no tomorrow, branded them as murderers, and then using the Mr. Big technique to extract a confession from them. This technique is actually illegal in the US, but legal in Canada where it was done. It involves undercover cops gaining the suspect's trust by involving them in illegal activities and then getting them to confess. Even with multiple alibis and no physical evidence, the undercover cop kept probing Burns to confess, and he would make it all go away. I'm assuming in the hopes of making his life go back to normal, Burns did confess, and later on so did Artif, even though their stories were completely different. Both were found guilty in 2004 of a triple murder and were both sentenced to 3 life sentences each, even though they've been in prison for the past 20 years. At first I thought, how could anyone murder their parents, but after doing this video and seeing how many people actually did, I was like, wow, this is a thing. This actually happens. At number 8 is Joshua Smith. Now, in February of 2012, 14-year-old Joshua broke into his stepfather Chico's room and stole his shotgun. Right after that, he started shooting things around the house, and Chico and his daughter were able to escape his rampage by breaking a window and climbing through. Joshua's mother, Tamiko Robinson, was sleeping on the sofa when he shot her around 12 to 14 times at close range. And why did he do this, you may be wondering? Because his mother was being a mother. That's right, Joshua started hanging out with the wrong crowd and wanted to join a gang, do drugs, pop pills. He started coming home at ridiculous hours, so Tomiko gave him a curfew and told him to stop hanging out with these people, and that's what triggered him. He pled guilty to second degree murder and will be in jail for anywhere from 30 to 50 years. Filling our number 7 slot now is Evan Miller. Now, Evan's life was hard enough. By the time he turned 14 in 2003, he'd been in and out of foster care due to his stepfather continuously beating him and his mother abusing drugs and alcohol. One day he was hanging out with his friends and his neighbor Cannon, who also happened to be one of his mum's drug dealers. After spending most of the night drinking and smoking weed, Evan and his friends attempted to rob Cannon after beating him. Evan beat him with a baseball bat and then set his trailer on fire, and he later died from his injuries and smoke inhalation. When brought to trial, his friend was offered life with a chance of parole if he testified against Evan, which obviously he did. In 2006, Evan was sentenced to life without parole, and now at 28 years old, he may have a chance at a retrial, but for now, he's still very much in prison. Now at number 6 is Jacob P. Ind. Back in 1992, when Jacob was 15 years old, he killed his mum and his stepdad. After enduring years of sexual, physical, and emotional abuse, Jacob hired another older teen to help him murder his parents. Then, in the morning of December 17th, they went to their bedroom where they were fast asleep and attacked them for 5 whole minutes using various gruesome methods, stabbing them, spraying their faces with bear mace, and shooting them as well. He never testified during his first trial since his defense told him he would pack up and leave if he tried, so he sentenced to life without parole. After spending 25 years in prison, he was finally granted a retrial and the right to testify back in August of 2018. And his retrial hasn't happened yet, so we don't know the conviction as of yet. Coming at number 5 is Diana Ortiz. Diana was 18 years old when she moved to New York in 1983 to flee an abusive relationship, and that's where she eventually met her new boyfriend, who was double her age. The man introduced her to drugs like heroin, LSD, and cocaine, and convinced that the only way to sustain both their habits was to stage a robbery. Note, not a murder, just a robbery. The plan was sorted. She would pose as a prostitute in a parking lot, wait for someone to approach her, and then her boyfriend and some friends would rob him. However, on the actual day, the victim that pulled up to her started fighting with the men, and a brawl ensued, and he was eventually shot. While they all ran off in separate directions, what they had no clue about was that the customer was actually an off-duty police officer, and he actually died a few days later. Diana turned herself in and was convicted of felony murder and was sentenced to 17 years to life. And after 22 and a half years in prison, she finally went on parole. Imagine 22 and a half years in prison. I'm only 21 right now, and I feel like I lived a long life. That's my life and then some, all in prison. I can't even imagine that. At number 4 is Quantel Lotz. Now, Lotz, like a lot of other kids on this list, had a troubled upbringing. His dad, mum, stepmom, uncles, aunts, basically everyone around him was addicted to cocaine, even getting high on it while he was still in the room at a very young age. He'd seen his uncle get shot multiple times because of drugs, and he himself was beaten on a regular basis. By 14, he used to have bouts of getting very angry, then crying uncontrollably, and then amnesia about what happened. In 1999, he was play fighting with his stepbrother Michael. It started off innocently, as it always does. Michael sent a blow dart his way, Lotz fired back with a toy bow and arrow, but then it turned very ugly and escalated into a proper fight. It ended with Lotz stabbing Michael a few times and then ultimately killing him. He literally doesn't remember the incident whatsoever. He just remembers being told the next day that his brother was dead and he was the reason. He was tried as an adult, not a juvenile, and was sentenced to life without the possibility of parole. Even though at 14 the state of Missouri thinks you're too young to legally get married, leave school, donate blood, get a tattoo without parental approval, yet you're old enough to be tried as an adult and then put away in jail forever. Filling in our number 3 slot is John Katis. Back in 2009, John was 16 at the time when he put up an ad on Craigslist offering sexual services in exchange for money, and the very popular ABC reporter George Weber replied to his ad. When they finally met up for the this kinky hookup, if we can call it that, John claimed that George pulled a knife on him and as self-defense, he stabbed George 50 times. Mind you, George was bound and being choked when this happens, so I don't know how he could have even pulled a knife out to begin with. And if it was really self-defense, why 50 times? Surely someone's dead after maybe a few, or at least injured enough for you to escape the situation. During his hearings and his confession tapes, you can see him literally wink and smile throughout. At 18 years old, John was found guilty and was sentenced to 25 years to life, and at 28 years old, he's still in prison today. Now at number 2 is Ashley Jones. Ashley was a problem child raised by problematic parents. Her stepdad used to sexually molest her, and her mum was a drug addict, so it appeared to be a blessing when her grandparents agreed to take in her and her sister. I don't know if they agreed to take her in or her parents kicked her out, since she stabbed both her dad and her pregnant mum a year beforehand. Luckily, neither died. A year later, at 14 years old, she was disobeying her grandparents more and more, and she was dating a boy they didn't approve of. The couple hatched a plan, and she helped her boyfriend commit a series of murders. First, they killed her granddad, shooting him twice in the face, and then stabbing him to death. Then her aunt, who they shot in her sleep, and then set them both on fire. They also attacked her grandmom, who also got burned on the face, stabbed in the chest and jaw, and shot in the shoulder. Luckily, she survived, and she also tried to kill her own 10-year-old sister by stabbing her 14 times, but she also survived, thank God. Now at 24 years old, she's still in prison serving out her life sentence. And finally, at number 1 is Erin Caffey. Way back in March of 2008, Erin started dating a boy called Charlie Wilkinson. Story seems pretty kosher so far. After meeting Charlie, her parents felt like there was something off about him but didn't worry too much, but then Erin started to change. Her interests changed, her demeanor changed, and her parents thought Charlie was a bad influence and wanted them to break up. So what do any desperate teenagers do in that situation? Hatch a plan. Charlie and his friend Wade went into Erin's house while she waited in the car with Wade's girlfriend and shot Erin's mother Penny whilst also nearly decapitating her with a katana. They then shot her youngest brother Matthew in the head while James and his friend both took turns stabbing her other brother Tyler. As if that wasn't bad enough, they then set the house on fire and it was completely ruined. Erin's father was also really badly injured. They shot him nearly 11 times whilst they killed Penny, but luckily he survived and was able to escape the house before it completely went up in flames. I mean, I don't know how lucky that is considering he survived his wife and kids and his remaining child is in jail, but it's still a good sign. Initially, no one suspected Erin, but during Charlie and Wade's questionings, they both said that the murders were Erin's idea. At 17 years old, Erin pleaded guilty to murder, as did Charlie, and they were both given 2 consecutive life sentences plus 25 years.
Starting off this countdown, we have Dennis Rader. Dennis Rader is an American serial killer who killed 10 people between 1974 to 1991. Now, Dennis likes to go by the name BTK, or the BTK Strangler, which stands for Bind 'em, Torture 'em, Kill 'em. So that right there says a lot about him. In 2005, he was convicted for his crimes, and there's this very creepy video of him detailing his murders. Currently, he is in solitary confinement, which he will be until the day he dies. To this day, though, he is still considered one of the most diabolical serial killers in American history. In our 9th spot, we have Ted Bundy. Ted Bundy was an infamous serial killer who was responsible for murdering 30 women, although it's thought that the number may have been higher. He would often kill these women in brutal ways. Now, one of the reasons why Bundy is on this list is because he managed to escape custody twice. The first time, he jumped out a second-story building and then fled. Eventually, he was caught, but then he escaped again. This time, he lost enough weight to squeeze through a hole in his cell's ceiling. Now, what's scary is that when he did escape, he went on to murder more women. As a result, he was considered a dangerous prison inmate that officers had to keep a close eye on. Moving on to number 8, we have the Eyeball Man. Maybe you've seen his picture, maybe you haven't. But once you have, I promise it will be ingrained in the back of your mind forever. Jason Barnum, otherwise known as the Eyeball Man, has a long list of crimes under his belt. He was sentenced to 22 years in jail after shooting a police officer. He is considered the Eyeball Man because, well, one of his eyeballs is tattooed completely black. On top of that, one side of his face is tattooed to look like a skull. So not only is this dude a dangerous criminal, but he looks like one too. In our seventh spot, we have Richard Lee McNair. Richard Lee McNair received 2 life sentences after being convicted of murder, attempted murder, and burglary. Now, the reason he is on this list is because he managed to escape prison 3 different times. The first time was in 1988 when he used lip balm to slide his handcuffs off. Then in 1992, he escaped again. And in 2006, he escaped for his last time by mailing himself out of prison. As a result, he was placed into Supermax prison. To this day, he is known as the Master Escapist. Making our way down the list at number 6, we have Roy Gardner. Roy Gardner was an American criminal. During the Roaring Twenties, he managed to steal more than $350,000 in cash, but clearly he didn't get away with it. But Roy did manage to escape from custody multiple times. He was considered the most dangerous inmate in the history of the Atlanta prison. Newspapers all across the coast had articles written about him, often referring to him as the Smiling Bandit or the Mail Train Bandit or King of the Escape Artists. Due to escaping custody multiple times, he was transferred to Alcatraz. From there, he was considered one of the most notorious and ruthless inmates at Alcatraz. We are now at our 5th and halfway mark with Robert Stroud. Robert Stroud, also known as the Birdman of Alcatraz, was the prison's most famous inmate. Stroud was imprisoned after violently killing a bartender. While in jail, he became a violent prisoner. He stabbed a prison guard, stabbed fellow prisoners, and would constantly get in fights with other inmates and staff. As a result, he was sentenced to an additional 6 months. He was considered very aggressive, violent, and cruel. Coming in at number 4, we have Barry Mills. Barry Mills was incarcerated at a very young age, and from there, he grew to be a brutal leader of a prison gang. This gang was huge across prisons. In fact, it resulted in numerous prison wars. It was said that he was admired by his inmates, but also highly feared by them. In fact, in 1979, he tried to decapitate an inmate in a bathroom stall in prison. In 2002, he was among 40 people charged with committing 32 murders or trying to. This gave him the name the Vengeful Killer. Again, this dude looks pretty terrifying, like he would always wear dark sunglasses because his eye got damaged in a prison fight. In our 3rd spot, we have Charles Bronson. Charles Bronson was an English criminal who gained the title the most violent prisoner in Britain, or Britain's most notorious prisoner. He was first arrested for armed robbery and served a 7-year sentence. Upon his release, he had a career in bare-knuckle boxing. Then in 1988, he was convicted of conspiracy to commit another robbery. However, this time when he went back to jail, he became a more violent inmate. In fact, there were multiple times where he took inmates as hostages. A famous quote from Bronson reads, "I'm a nice guy, but sometimes I lose all my senses and become nasty." In our 2nd spot, we have Thomas Edward Silverstein. If you Google who is the most dangerous inmate, this dude, Thomas Edward Silverstein, will pop up. Now, don't judge a book by its cover. At first I saw his image and I was like, there's no way that this dude is possibly scary. Boy, was I wrong. So Silverstein was originally jailed for armed robbery, but while in prison, he committed numerous other crimes. First, he killed one of his officers, in which he stabbed multiple times. Then he murdered multiple other inmates. As a result, he had to be detained in a specially designed cell at the ADX Florence Federal Penitentiary in Colorado. Due to the crimes he committed while in jail, he is considered the most violent prisoner in America. And in our 1 spot, we have Robert Maudsley. Robert Maudsley is considered Britain's most dangerous prisoner. In fact, he is so dangerous that he is kept locked up in a glass cell underneath Wakefield Jail. He spends 23 hours of his day in solitary confinement. Now, why is he so dangerous? Well, in 1977, Maudsley and his fellow inmate held another prisoner hostage. They tortured him for 9 hours before cracking his head open and killing him. It's rumored that he may have also eaten some of the prisoner's brain. As a result, he was deemed the real-life Hannibal Lecter. A couple months later, he murdered 2 other inmates. Then he casually told the prison officer that during the next roll call, he would be 2 prisoners short.
Starting off this list in our number 10 spot, we have Rose West. Rose West is an English serial killer who committed her crimes alongside her husband. He definitely also would make a spot on this list, but he decided to take his own life in 1995 after being arrested while awaiting trial. The terrible pair were investigated and subsequently arrested for taking 9 lives together, with Rose receiving an additional charge for another 10th life. During the court proceedings, against the advice of her counsel, Rose decided that she would testify herself, and what a trip that was. During her testimony, she sometimes was very tearful and dramatic, but of course, an act like that can be hard to keep up, so other times she was cracking jokes and laughing. Imagine doing your type 5 while you're on trial for the worst of the worst crimes. Luckily, it seems as though the jury hated that as much as I do, because they came back with a unanimous verdict of guilty on all 10 crimes. Get this though, in prison, Rose West met Myra Hindley, which if you don't know who that is, she committed a bunch of very similar crimes with her husband as well, and the two became besties and even had an affair. But throughout this whole thing, Rose is still trying to say that she was totally innocent and that Fred was completely responsible for all of the crimes. So wild. In our number 9 spot today, we have Dennis BTK Rader. The BTK killer, whose real name is Dennis Rader, was one of the worst serial killers from 1974 to 1991. He left taunting letters for police and newspapers where he described his crimes, but thankfully, this annoyingly large and misplaced ego is what led to his demise. After a 10-year hiatus from his disgusting crimes, he couldn't keep his mouth shut, so he began communicating with the media again in 2004. This communication, combined with his lack of knowledge on how technology works, led to his arrest in 2005. During his trial, he didn't apologize for his crimes, but he did describe them in full detail, which is horrifying and extremely eerie. I could not even imagine having to be there during that. After his trial, he ended up being sentenced to 10 consecutive life sentences with a minimum of 175 years. When Rader was first arrested, when the police were taking him to the station, an officer asked him, "Mr. Rader, do you know why you're going downtown?" To which he replied, "Oh, I have suspicions why." In our number 8 spot today, we have Randy Kraft. Also known as the scorecard killer, Randy is a monster who took the lives of at least 16 young men between 1972 and 1983. The scorecard nickname comes from how, after his arrest, police found a coded list that contained cryptic references to his crimes and the victims. On May 14, 1983, 2 California Highway Patrol officers observed a car driving erratically and suspected that the driver may be impaired, so they pulled it over. Once the car pulled over, Randy Kraft got out and identified himself and subsequently failed all field sobriety tests. At the same time, the other officer went over to the passenger side where he sadly found Randy's final victim, 25-year-old Marine Terry Lee Gambrill. The next 2 days of investigation revealed the horrors of what Kraft had done, and on May 16, 1983, he was formally charged with the one crime, but many more charges came in the next months. His trial first began on September 26, 1988, and on August 11, 1989, the jury rendered a verdict of death and the sentence was upheld. As of this year, he still remains on death row at San Quentin State Prison, where he continues to deny any responsibility for the crimes. Like they didn't find one of his victims in the passenger seat of his car. I think the gimmick might be up, Randy. In our number 7 spot today, we have the Sleepy Hollow Killer. Starting in 1997, there were a series of killings in an area of South Africa that are all believed to be linked to one unidentified suspect, who's being called the Sleepy Hollow Killer. During this time, it was believed that 13 crimes could be attributed to this person, and despite investigations, whoever the perpetrator was, authorities were unable to identify them. There was a small hiatus from the crimes, which is sometimes referred to as a cooling off period, but in 2007, they unfortunately began again. While the more recent crimes varied slightly from the originals, authorities believe it is the same person, active yet again. There has only been one public suspect in this case,
but unfortunately it is no longer believed that he had anything to do with these crimes and that the one he committed was entirely separate. It really is horrifying to think of people who do things like this being able to get away with it for a number of years, so let's just hope that they are caught very soon. The good news is that a special task team has been formed in order to really look into these crimes and explore and examine all of the circumstances, modus operandi, and all of the material evidence. In our number 6 spot today, we have Paul Bernardo and Carla Homolka. This is a double whammy because unfortunately both of these people are still alive, but the good news is that at least one of them, Paul, is still in jail. This horrible pair are often referred to as the Ken and Barbie killers, and while Paul started off living a life of crime, he quickly brought Carla into it as well after their meeting. That is not to say she is not just as guilty as him, however, because they are both fully responsible for their own actions. While Paul was arrested for a multitude of crimes, the pair were arrested and convicted of taking the lives of 3 separate people, one of them being Carla's sister. See what I meant about them both being responsible for their own actions? The investigation into the crimes proved to be quite difficult, with authorities having plenty of hoops to jump through, and this is why a plea deal was created for Carla. She had 1 week to accept or decline the deal, which would give her a sentence of 12 years for her full cooperation. She accepted. Both were convicted in 2005, and Paul was up to apply for parole in 2018, and in October of that year, he was denied parole. His next parole hearing was recently on June 22nd of this year, and it only took an hour of deliberation to decide to turn down that application as well. I think 30 seconds probably would have been enough to decide, but I'm just glad the outcome was the same. Carla, on the other hand, served her 12-year sentence and then was released, like years ago. She moved away from Canada and headed to Costa Rica for a while with her new husband and children, if you can believe that. But unfortunately, she has since moved back. In our number 5 spot today, we have Edmund Kemper. Edmund Kemper is an American serial killer who was convicted for taking the lives of 10 people, including his paternal grandparents, as well as his own mother. Wikipedia told me that he is noted for his height, as he is 6'9", and for his intelligence, as he apparently has an IQ of 145, but I personally think that he is most notable for being an absolute monster. His first crime took place when he was just 15 years old, and that was when he took the lives of his grandparents. After this crime, he was diagnosed with paranoid schizophrenia and spent time in a hospital before it was determined he was rehabilitated and he was released at the age of 21. After his release, he unfortunately went on a spree where he would target young females who were hitchhiking. After his final crimes, he ended up confessing and turning himself in, which is something we really don't see all of the time. When asked in an interview why he confessed, he said, "The original purpose was gone. It wasn't serving any physical or real or emotional purpose. It was just a pure waste of time." 3 court-appointed psychiatrists examined and observed him and found him to be legally sane, and thus he was able to stand trial. On November 8, 1973, the jury deliberated for just 5 hours before returning a verdict of guilty. He has been eligible for parole since 1979 and has been denied every single time he applied, one time saying, "Society is not ready in any shape or form for me." I can't fault them for that. He is eligible to apply for parole again next in 2024. In our number 4 spot today, we have the Long Island serial killer. Also known as the Craigslist Ripper, the LISK is an unidentified suspect who is believed to have taken the lives of somewhere between 10 to 16 people over the last 20 years. The victims so far that are known have been sex workers who use Craigslist to advertise their work. After the disappearance of Shannon Gilbert, police were searching an area along the Ocean Parkway, and that is when they began to discover the remains of the victims. The first 4 were found in December of 2010, with another 6 being found in March and April of 2011. As of December 2015, the FBI is now officially involved in the investigation. There has been a suspect in the case, but any formal charges have not been laid in terms of these crimes. The most recent evidence in regards to these cases was a belt found at the scene of the crime, which may potentially belong to the killer. At this same time, it was announced that new scientific evidence was being used in the investigation, but these announcements came just last year, so we have yet to receive any further updates. Hopefully the case is solved quickly so that the families of the victims can receive justice and this terrible person is off the streets for good. In our number 3 spot today, we have Robert Picton. This horrible person is one of the worst Canadians to ever live and is one of our country's worst serial killers ever. Picton dropped out of school and began working at his family's pig farm, and this is where most of his absolutely horrific crimes took place. He was first arrested in 2002 and was convicted convicted in 2007 of taking the lives of 6 people, but throughout an extremely lengthy investigation, evidence of many more killings came to light. Unfortunately, in 2010, the Crown stayed the rest of the charges, but I suppose at least he was convicted of the 6 he was initially charged with. During his time in jail, an undercover police officer posed as his cellmate, and Picton confessed to 49 crimes to him. Apparently, he was saying to the undercover officer that he wanted to take one more life to make it an even 50, and that he only got caught because he was sloppy. Which is super ironic, considering you're confessing your crimes to an undercover officer. The entire trial was a bit of a mess, but it led to a life sentence without the possibility of parole for 25 years, which was the longest possible sentence under Canadian law at that time. This unfortunately does mean that he will be eligible for parole within the next decade, so here's hoping that that never, ever happens. In our number 2 spot today, we have Peter Tobin. Peter Tobin is a serial killer who was convicted for 3 separate crimes, but it is believed his crimes may actually be up in the range of 40 to 50. Before being convicted of these crimes, Peter also served another 10-year prison sentence for other crimes committed, and he was released from prison for those crimes in 2004. 3 years later, however, he was sentenced to life with a minimum of 21 years for taking the life of Angelica Kluk in 2006. After this, remains of 2 more people who went missing in 1991 were found in his former home, and he was also tried for these crimes, which ended up solidifying his sentence to a whole life order, which means he will never be up for parole. There are some who believe Tobin is responsible for more unsolved crimes, and he has been labeled a psychopath by a senior psychologist. Apparently, while in prison, he has boasted about taking the lives of 48 people, despite the fact that he's only officially been linked to 3. Hopefully, if this is true, the connections are discovered soon so that the families and loved ones of those victims can receive the justice that they deserve. In our number 1 spot today, we have Gary Ridgway. This horrible human being is also sometimes known as the Green River Killer, and his crimes took place somewhere between 1982 to potentially as recent as 2001. He was convicted for 49 crimes, but confessed to an unbelievable 71, which makes him the 2nd most prolific serial killer in the United States in terms of confirmed killings. Most of his victims were either sex workers or women in other vulnerable circumstances, and through DNA profiling evidence, in 2001, authorities were able to connect him to 4 of his crimes. From there, they made a deal with him where they would spare him the death sentence in exchange for the disclosure of the location of all of the missing women. Gary took the deal and was spared a death sentence, and instead was sentenced to life without the possibility of parole. Not only did he say that he chose the type of victims he did because they were easy to pick up and that he hated most of them, but he also called his crimes his career. So, he sucks.